Thank you very much, Jose Manuel. We have now heard about the experience from the US, from China, from the EU, and now we are going to the African experience. I would like to introduce Lucilla Steinaa. She is principal scientist at the International Livestock Research Institute in Nairobi, Kenya, and she leads projects for developing an attenuated vaccine using gene editing and subunit vaccine for control of African swine fever. We are looking forward to your presentation, Lucilla.
Good morning, everyone, and thanks to the organizers for the opportunity to talk today. I'm going to talk about recent advances in African swine fever vaccine development at ILRI. The African swine fever situation in Africa is quite different from what we know from East Europe and Asia. One thing is that all the known 24 genotypes are present in Africa, and the virus is present in about 26 African countries with regular outbreaks, also depending on the number of pigs and pig production in the respective countries. There's a wildlife reservoir in warthogs and bush pigs, which are both resistant to the disease. Soft ticks of the genus Ornithodorus are involved in the transmission of African swine fever virus. Here we see the phylogenetic tree of the various viruses with the different clusters here and the genotypes based on the P72 gene sequence. And these clusters seem to coincide with geographic clusters. If we look at genotype 1 here, we have it predominantly in Western Africa, genotype 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on in Southern Africa, genotype 8, 11, 12, and so on in Eastern, Southern Africa, and 9 and 10 in Central and Eastern Africa. So this also makes the situation very different regarding vaccine development because the gene pool is a lot bigger and more diverse in Africa compared to the European and Asian situation. Now, some time ago, ILRI isolated a genotype 9 virus together with DBS in Kenya. And that was isolated from a zone with outbreaks at the border of Uganda and Kenya. And that has been used as a backbone for deletion of genes to generate attenuated viruses. And we have also established an animal model with this wild-type virus. So that leads towards the work we have been doing to get an attenuated vaccine for African swine fever. So we use CRISPR-Cas9 modification of African swine fever to obtain deletions. I'll not go into a lot of details of the methodology, but for those who don't know the system, Cas9 is an enzyme that can cleave double-stranded DNA. And there are two repair pathways. The non-homology end-joining pathway, written here, and the homology-directed recombination pathway. With this pathway, the cell will produce indels, and with this pathway, you provide donor DNA with homology arms, and then you get a recombination event. So you can knock in a fluorochrome at the same time as you knock out a gene of interest. So we started out with this pathway first and generated one mutant. But what we observed was many in-frame indels. So that was quite laborious to work through all the clones. And then in the end, it was in-frame indels because the problem is then the protein might still work since it's in-frame. So we swapped to the other method, where we have now generated 7 to 10 different mutants, while we still have some of these in in the procedure of being cloned. So they are ready for animal experiments. And for this, we have made first a batch of the wild type rice, where we tested different doses here, 10 to the 2, 3, 4, and 5. And basically all the animals went down by day 8. In the highest dose, they went down slightly earlier than in the smallest. So we have picked 10 to the 2 as the challenge dose. We have also checked the virulence of the WSL adapted wild type virus. So we use 10 to the 2 TCID 50 to test the virus grown in macrophages versus the virus grown in WSL cells. So the virus had passaged 20 plus times in the WSL cells. And what we see here is very similar clinical scores in animals. And they went down at the same time point, so there's no attenuation of the virus grown in WSL. We have also done NGS, and FLI has also done it, and we see indeed very few mutations, only a single a few mutations that we are now checking with PCR whether it's due to NGS errors. So the first viruses to be tested are the CD2V knockout and a double knockout with CD2V and A238L. The CD2V has been suggested to be an immunomodulatory molecule promoting apoptosis of lymphocytes. And the A238L mimics the NF-kappa B subunit that then inhibits the activity, which is crucial in the pro-inflammatory response towards the virus infection. So the first virus here, the CD2V knockout, was done by FLI in collaboration with ILRI some time ago in a former project. And then our group has now added some mutations, where this is one of them. And we have also done new mutations in the wild type without the CD2V. So the experimental setup can be seen here. We are using one injections. We are using three groups, 10 to the 4 TCID of each of the virus of the CD2V knockout and the double knockout, and a PBS group. And then we have 9 animals in each group. We then challenge only 8 animals with 10 to the 2 of the wild type. We have this set up because we sometimes have seen that we can lose an animal due to non-ASF related things like an abscess or something, and we wanted to end with 8 animals per group. So we have 3 weeks of quarantine. They are tested ASF-free, and we do clinical scoring after the immunization and also after challenge and the sampling, of course. So here you see the clinical scores after immunization. This is the CD2V knockout, and there are a number of peaks here. So these pigs were not completely happy with this immunization, but they all made it through. The next one here is the double knockout, which looks far better. So they seem to be more attenuated. And here we have the PBS group. We have a few small peaks, which is due to some lameness observed in some of the bigger peaks, likely due to the floor in the animal facility. So we are looking into getting some mats for this. The weight gain here, we have the highest weight gain in the PBS group and equal weight gain in the other two groups, slightly lower And this is the summation of the animals in the three groups. So here are the clinical scores after challenge. This is the CD2V group, where we have some clinical scores during the challenge. We actually lose one animal because it has temperature for quite some days. So that was euthanized. And here in the double knockout, we have three animals that we lose early and then one later. So we have 7 out of 8 surviving here and 4 out of 8 in this group. This is the PBS group where all go down quite fast. And here you see the overlay. So the first ones from the double knockout goes down at the same time as the PBS group. There's no delay in disease there, but some of them are protected, as you see here. And this is the average of the different groups. So here we have the survival plot. So this is the CD2V knockout group where we lost one animal. So 7 out of 8 are protected. And in the double knockout, we have 4 out of 8 protected. And this is the control group. So these two are both significantly different than the control group. So the remaining data are the viremia from blood and nasal swabs. This experiment has just been done, so we have not yet analyzed all the samples that we took. We have done autopsies, so and microscopic pathology, and we can see because we had these three animals extra, one from each of the immunization group, that there is an effect on the organs, especially in the CD2V knockout group. They look, in fact, quite bad. It's far better in the double knockout, but there is also a little effect there compared to the PBS group. We will also get some immunological data and ILRI spot and antibodies. So in conclusion, both viruses are attenuated, but not sufficiently. All pigs survived the immunization with 10 to the 4 TCID 50. The CD2V knockout seemed to be more efficient than the double knockout, but less attenuated. So we had 87.5 protection with the CD2V versus 50% with the double knockout. The A238L knockout seems to add to the attenuation, but with a loss in ability to protect. It is a possibility to do 2 injections with the double knockout, probably then in a lower dose than we have used here. But that would be to run a little bit on the edges. So I would say that the next step is to test other mutations. Now, this leads towards the subunit vaccine for African swine fever, where we also have a product. I only have a few slides and not time to show everything. So we used the CD2V for immunizing some pigs, European breed pigs and local breed pigs, for looking at the immune responses and the reaction to the various antigens from the virus. So this is how it looks. We have here the red is the local breed. This is the clinical score. And here we have the temperature. So we can see that the local breed cope better with the infection or the immunization, we can say, for the CD2V injection. These animals were then used for looking at reaction in ELISA spots. So we used PBMC on overlapping peptides spanning the entire proteome. And these are the ELISPOT data. So we have the different gene pools from all these peptides, 217 gene pools, but in peptides, obviously, in all. And we had 42 pools recognized in all three screenings. It's divided in three screenings, one local and two with European pigs. 62 pools were not recognized at all. That's all the blue up here. And then you can see some gene pools here. That's the gene pools. Were recognized quite uniformly or by a lot of animals. Each of these ones is an animal. So if we look at this plot, these are the three screenings represented by a circle, and then we have 42 pools here, which are recognized in all three screenings by if we use PPMC. Far less in common if we go to the CD8 cells. So we screen also CD8 cells. If we now go to single antigen recognition by number of animals, we see here for the PPMC that the best recognition of a single antigen was obtained in 17 out of 20 animals. So 17 animals recognized a particular antigen out of these 22. For CD8 cells, this was 6 animals out of the 22. And from these numbers, obviously for different antigens, it would be then be 16, 15, and so on out of the 22 animals. We have then selected 10 antigens to include in viral vectors, adenovirus, and MVA vectors, and then we want to test these vectors in pools in animals. So this is still to be done. With that, I come to the acknowledgement, and this is the ILRI group. And Hussein Abkalu here, who has done a lot on the CRISPR, and Hanneke Hemming, who has done a lot on animal experiments. And we have here the CD2V knockout virus, which was done by FLI. Günter Keil, Raquel Portugal, and Sandra Blume was involved, and Richard Bishop from ILRI at that point. We have the wild-type virus that was isolated by Richard and Edward, and then our current collaborators Sanjay Vashi and Walter Fuchs on the IDRC project, who are in particular involved in a reverse genetic system for African swine fever that I haven't talked about today. That can be another time. Thank you and goodbye.
Thanks, Lucilla, for the presentation. We have actually reached our coffee break. We are a bit ahead of schedule,